the late nights is The Voice and okay. Dancing with the Stars.
There you go.
And then the heavier stuff is Good Wife, How to Get Away with Murder, and of course Scandal.
Okay.
DVR those things, and I usually have to beg my wife because I'll get home somewhere between 11, somewhere around 11:15, and I just ask her just one show. So it all depends. I know if I get home before 11. You know, we can get probably one of the more intense shows in. If it's a little bit after 11, then it's one of the little lighter ones. So that's critical. That's critical as far as planning is concerned.
Do you have a favorite on Dancing with the Stars? I know it's been going on for a couple weeks. So, golly.
I don't know. You know, when I was in college, you know, Cheech and Chong was big. I don't know Chong's name, but, you know, he's on there. He's still alive. I don't know how. I think he's just a likable character. I just like watching it, you know. I wish I could dance like that, you know. That's pretty cool. I think I could dance like that, but I don't know if I'd have the courage just to let it go, you know, and get into the music, as they say.
Are you pretty light on your feet?
I'm pretty light on my feet. Yeah, I'm pretty light on my feet. My wife's a dancer fool now. The toughest,
okay.
You know, weddings are always good to go to, a celebration or things like that, but you know, I still get sweaty palms because my wife always wants me to get up and dance, and that's always a sticking point, you know. But if we're going to go home happy, I've got to get up there and, you know, do a little shuffle out on the dance floor.
So you say you DVR them, obviously, because you're still here when they're airing. So does your wife, does she always be like, well, I want to watch it live, or does she?
Oh, no. She is a true coach's
okay.
wife. She and very, very unselfish. She might peek at it, but she'll let me know, hey, I saved it. You know, I did not watch it. And then she has other shows. She DVRs, so she gets that out of the way. Like when the Bachelorette or the Bachelor something's on.
That's my mom's
I make sure that I always ask her, please watch that when I'm not here, because I just can't stand that stuff right there. That's just so fake. And I don't think people should meet like that, you know.
Right.
So anyway.
Yeah. Football related, I know that you know, you're concerned about Stanford's offense and how to stop them, but I'm sure you're obviously well aware of how good their defense is. So do you tell your guys, hey, expect to, you know, kind of grind it out, gutty type of game on Saturday?
No, I mean, we've got enough things to handle, you know. Week in and week out, you know, there'll be a mention about that and kind of where teams are and what we need to do, but you know, it's all about points. You know, in this conference, I think a few weeks ago, I said if you could keep a team under 25 points, you got a better chance than not to win the way things are. And then you've got a few teams like these guys right here now. They have not been scoring a lot of points. I'm sure they're going to break out of that sooner or later. I hope it's later than sooner. At the same time, they're absolutely the stingiest defense there. So, yeah, we've made comments about that so that that when we talk about their offense, we talk about their team too and kind of where they're at, their strong points, their weaknesses, and what we need to do and what our team's going to rely on us to do. But it's still about points. I mean, you don't want to give up points. And at the same time, you know, stay away from the big plays, make your open field tackles, and then execute every call, win more downs than the other team does, and then win the current play, and then when that's over, go on to the next one. And just try to stay in that mindset without, you know, clouding it up, you know, too much other than that.
When you look at them on film, obviously Hogan's been around a while, and they've got some new guys up front on the offensive line. The run game maybe isn't what it's been in the past. Just what are the biggest things that stick out about this particular offense?
Well, you know, right now it's a little bit of a quandary because, you know, they've been about 40% run and 60% pass, and that hasn't been them. So, you know, I think it's just for them, you know, they have established a little bit of a different identity. They're running the ball at times a little bit more out of one back. But I've got to believe they're going to come back, you know, with the two backs and get them big fellas rolling, because that offensive line is big, physical. They're tough. They've been, you know, running by committee. They've got about four to five backs that they can choose from. You know, I would think that they've got to do that, and that's what we've told the group. We have to stop the run. We've got to, you know, make them doubt, I guess, or whatever they're going through. And maybe they don't want to run the ball as much as they have. Maybe they want to put it on Hogan and Montgomery and the receivers and the tight ends. I don't know. I really don't really care. But we need to be able to stop the run and be able to be more physical than they are up front. and you know, and we practiced the different run rotations and things like that where we need to show up our fits. And at the same time, you know, because you're packing the box and things like that, that's where guys like Montgomery, Kajust, and those kind of guys, they hurt you because now, you know, they're going to get your corners one-on-one. At some point in time, those corners are always one-on-one. And the ball's sometimes not even thrown that deep. It's thrown right there at the line of scrimmage, and they say, see if you can make a tackle and go make a play. So, as always, it goes true to form. You know, we've got to be able to stop the run, and then we've got to get them to third down, and then that's where we got to figure out how to get off the field on third downs and don't take any more unnecessary reps than we need to, because we're going to need all our physicality and energy in that run game. And not let them wear us down.
When you look back at the Utah game, I mean, you only give up 16 points in regulation. That's good enough to win a lot of Pac-12 games, and just really had the one long drive. Yeah. How do you overall assess just, you know, that performance and how you can maybe build on?
Well, you know, I terrible. You know, felt terrible for our team. I know, as the coordinator of the defense, I felt like just personally, I just let everybody down. You know, by not winning that game, because, I mean, they couldn't move the ball on us. They were 0-for-12 at one time on third down. We were doing a great job in the run game. And what it came down to for us was three plays. You know, basically things that we inflicted upon ourselves. You know, one that somebody was trying to make a play, they spun out of a gap for a 52-yard run, which resulted in a field goal. We could have used those 3 points back at the end of the game. Another one coming right out of the chute. We had a unblocked player just running right at the back because that was his assignment. He took a bad angle, still was on the back to be able to get him down, but missed the tackle. We had somebody else miss the tackle. That was 39 yards. And then we were in position on a second and 10. All we had to do was run through the gap. And instead of being on an edge, we got thick on the ball carrier, a smaller player, a defensive back, a safety. Got turned by a big old offensive lineman, and he ended up scoring. So on three plays, they had 108 yards. And, you know, you can't say, hey, if it wasn't for those three plays, because they could say, hey, if it wasn't for the other 60 plays, we would have won handily. But, you know, that's life. And it was really disappointing because we had been working so hard in practice. And then it came to fruition in the game. You know, one of our biggest goals in the game was make sure that quarterback didn't run the ball on us. And golly, I mean, some guys made some unbelievable plays. I could think of three plays, just one-on-one tackle, you know, two by Justin that he was just tracking the quarterback, another one by Jabril Johnson. And, you know, the plan worked. And unfortunately, and again, it's one of those, it just sticks in your craw. It's always going to be there. It doesn't go away. I was telling one of the safeties, I said, you know, when I'm about 95 years old and you're about 72, and that was kind of a stretch of imagination. He'd probably be more like maybe 55 or something. But, you know, I said, that'll be the first thing I say to you. Why couldn't you just, you know, been in that gap? But at the same time, you know, as a signal call, you say, hey, why didn't we call something else and make something else work? But that can't beat us twice. We got to let that go, move on. That's the game. When you compete, you compete. Somebody's going to win, somebody's going to lose, you know, and it just stinks that it was us on the short end, and we got to go out and get this Stanford game.
Awesome. I've heard so many good things about Scandal, and that's like next on my list of like things.
Yeah, you know, it's a long, but see, the one thing you get into the characters.
Yeah. My mom's obsessed with it. She's like every single day.